Jai Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Om namo bhagavate vasudevaya.
Om namo bhagavate vasudevaya.
Om namo bhagavate vasudevaya.
Om namo bhagavate vasudevaya.
Om namo bhagavate vasudevaya. So welcome all dear devotees from London and beyond. I see devotees from different parts of the world also are with us today. We thank you very much for giving us this opportunity. It's quite appropriate, as I said, that the last online or on stage is the ass. So we hope that we'll be able to remove that ass this evening and become a das. If we're not a das, we'll be an ass. So let's hear something first of all. I thought we would begin, if it's okay with you, by reading a short account from Srila Prabhupada in the Krishna book of the deliverance of the Dhenukasura demon. And then we'll take it from there. I'm not sure exactly what the format of other speakers has been, but we'll do what we can. So if you want to follow, this is from the Krishna book, The Killing of Dhenukasura. So we've heard how Krishna, his coward boyfriends, and Balaram were joyfully playing in the forest, admiring the beauty of the Vrindavan forest, and how Krishna was glorifying Lord Balaram. And how all the trees and creepers were bowing down to his lotus feet, and how they were enjoying themselves like anything, imitating all the animals and all the birds and the frogs and everybody in the forest of Vrindavan, and playing all kinds of games with each other, the spiritual realm. And amongst those games, one of Krishna's favorites, especially in this particular age, we're in the Poganda era now, and Krishna really enjoys killing demons in the forest. It's a great fun, and for devotees, we'll hear about that later, how this is relevant and joyful activity. Even in the spiritual realm, of course, Gokul Vrindavan is the spiritual realm, but in Goloka Vrindavan, it's also described how Yogamaya, although there were no demons in Goloka Vrindavan, for the sake of fun, she creates apparent demons, and Krishna and the coward boys joyfully perform pastimes like this one, in playing with the demons and then killing the demons, and then they forget all about it. And by Yogamaya's arrangement, they can do it all over again. Eternal pastimes. And so we're going to read now from, well, I don't know which book you've got. I've got this book, Krishna book. Probably upside back to front to you, I don't know. But I've got Krishna book here. And this is page 135, The Killing of Dhenukasura. Well, Krishna was thus engaged in his transcendental pastimes, exhibiting his internal potency in the company of the supermost fortunate cowherd boys. There occurred another chance for him to exhibit the superhumane powers of Godhead. His most intimate friends, Sri Dama, Subala, and Stoka Krishna, addressed Krishna and Balaram with great love and affection thus. Dear Balaram, you are very powerful. Your arms are very strong. Dear Krishna, you are very expert in killing all kinds of disturbing demons. Will you kindly note that just near this place, there is a big forest of the name Talavan. This forest is full of palm trees, and all the trees are filled with fruits. Some are falling down, and some are very ripe, even in the trees. It's a very nice place, but because of a great demon, Dhenukasura, it is very difficult to go there. No one can reach the trees to collect the fruits. Dear Krishna Balaram, this demon is present there in the form of an ass. And he is surrounded by similar demon friends who have assumed the same shape. All of them are very strong, so it is very difficult to approach this place. Dear brothers, you are the only persons who can kill such demons. Other than you, no one can go there for fear of being killed. Not even animals go there. And no birds are living there. They've all left. It was actually Dhenukasura was a man-eating ass. He wasn't just an ordinary ass. He was quite fierce and powerful. And no other entity would dare reside in that forest of Talavan. One can only appreciate the sweet aroma that is coming from that place. It appears that up until now, no one has tasted the sweet fruits there, either on the tree or on the ground. Dear Krishna, to tell you frankly, we are very attracted by this sweet aroma. Dear Balaram, if you like, let us go there and enjoy these fruits. The aroma of the fruits is now spread everywhere. Don't you smell it from here? They were just trying to incite more pastimes. And the whole idea of many of these various statements is to excite Krishna or Balaram to perform wonderful activities for their own pleasure, for the benefit of those involved in the activities, and for the benefit of all those who are able to hear those activities in the future. When Balaram and Krishna were thus petitioned by their intimate friends, they were inclined to please them. And with smiling faces, they proceeded toward the forest, surrounded by all of their friends. Are we all ready? Everybody ready to enter into the Talavan forest and taste the sweet tall fruits? They're also very tall. Immediately, upon entering the Talavan forest, Balaram began to yank the trees with his arms, exhibiting the strength of an elephant. Because of this jerking, all the ripe fruits fell down on the ground. Upon hearing the sound of the falling fruits, the demon, Dhenukasura, who was living there in the form of an ass, approached with great force, shaking the whole field so that all the trees moved as if there were an earthquake. Said the whole world shook, actually, when Dhenukasura, it's described by some of the acharyas, he was taking a nap, a midday nap. And Balaram, different descriptions are there in different scriptures, no doubt, but from the Bhagavatam, we'll stick with the Bhagavatam. But when Balaram shook the trees, Dhenukasura arose in great anger. How dare someone disturb my comfort zone? You ever had that experience? When you're nicely comfort zone and somebody interferes with their sense gratification. We get quite angry sometimes. And Dhenukasura was no exception. The demon appeared before Balaram and kicked his chest with his hind legs. And normally asses, they, when they attack someone or want to go for someone, they rear end and they kick you with their back legs. They got powerful back legs. At first, Balaram did not say anything, but with great anger, the demon kicked him again, more vehemently. This time, Balaram immediately caught hold of the legs of the ass with one hand and, wheeling him around, threw him into the treetops. While he was being wheeled around by Balaram, the demon lost his life. Balaram threw the demon into the biggest palm tree about, and the demon's body was so heavy that the palm tree fell upon other trees and several fell down. It appeared as if a great hurricane was passing through the forest, and all the trees were falling down one after another. This exhibition of extraordinary strength is not astonishing, because Balaram is the personality of Godhead, known as Anantashesha Naga, who is holding all the planets on the hoods of his millions of heads. He maintains the whole cosmic manifestation, exactly as horizontal and vertical threads hold the weaving of a cloth. After the demon had been thrown into the trees, all the friends and associates of Dhenukasura immediately assembled and attacked Balaram and Krishna with great force. They were determined to retaliate and avenge the death of their friend. But Krishna and Balaram caught each of the asses by the hind legs and, exactly in the same way, wheeled them around. Thus they killed all of them and threw them into the palm trees. Because of the dead bodies of the asses, there was a panoramic scene. It appeared as if clouds of various colors were assembled in the trees. Hearing of this great incident, the demigods on the higher planets showered flowers on Krishna and Balaram and beat their drums and offered devotional prayers. It said the scene was very, very beautiful. Krishna really appreciated these special colors. The demons were very dark, like a dark blue, purpley color. And there was blood all over the place. And these green trees and the tall fruits and the fragrance, everything was very scenic. All arranged for the pleasure of Krishna and his associates. Very pleasing, although it sounds very ghastly scene. It was actually very pleasing in one sense. And then a few days after the killing of Dhenukasura, people began to come into the Talavan forest to collect the fruits, and animals began to return without fear to feed on the nice grasses growing there. Just by chanting or hearing these transcendental activities and pastimes of the brothers, Krishna and Balaram, we can amass pious activities. So that's the end of the specific pastime of the killing of Dhenukasura in the Talavan forest. And we can read in different acharyas have written different texts describing this pastime. There are quite a few, Jiva Goswami, Kavi Karnapura, the Garga Samhita, Hari Vamsa, so many scriptures have slightly different versions of this pastime, but the basic principle is the same and the purpose is the same. Krishna performs so many wonderful pastimes in this world to, say, attract the attention of the jivas, to attract our attention, draw our attention, give us something to think about. It's very nice to think about these pastimes. even though I'm so many demons, I remember there's one other demon. We'll read in a minute how Bhaktivinoda Thakur describes how these two demons who were killed by Balaram in Vrindavan have to be removed on our spiritual path. Dhenukasura being one and the other being Pulambasura. And I remember, as you're in England, maybe some of you are from Birmingham, I don't know, but the first time I ever came across the Hare Krishna movement was in Birmingham. And the first way I came across was not by meeting a devotee. I found in one of my friend's apartments, the Back to Godhead magazine. And on the back of that magazine was a picture of Balaram killing Pulambasura. And you probably know how he killed him. He beat him with his fist. Pulambasura was huge and he was black as ink, black colored. And Balaram was as white as milk. And he's on the back of this big black demon on the shoulders, punching him with blood pouring out of his mouth, and the demon is falling to his death. And I thought, this is incredible. Here we are in the black country of Birmingham, and they're distributing a magazine with a white man punching a black man to death. Well, this is really far out. What is this? Because I didn't understand anything about transcendence. People don't understand. And this is one of the essence of this pastime of Dhenukasura. There's a history which we'll tell in a second, but it's really to destroy gross ignorance. We'll hear about that much more later on. There's a little history behind this. Why Balaram? Why not Krishna? Well, it's described that in a previous lifetime, but actually this Dhenukasura was a son of Bali Maharaj. He was one of his sons, and he was known as Sasikala. And he was rather licentious. You can imagine the son of Bali would be princes. They're usually very spoiled, and they like to enjoy their senses. So Sasikala was very much enjoying his senses with 10,000 maidens. Huh? Gandhamadana in the heavenly planets. There he was enjoying sensual activities with all these young ladies. But he didn't know that not far away was Durvasa Muni performing meditation. And suddenly the disturbing sounds of the son of Bali Maharaj and all these ladies stopped his meditation. He became quite angry. And naturally, as we know from Durvas, he does get angry quite easily, being a partial expansion of Lord Shiva. So he came to see what was going on. And there was this rascal enjoying himself. He cursed him. "You nonsense rascal. You are just like an ass. May you become an ass for 400,000 years. You become an ass. And only by good fortune will you be delivered by Lord Balaram. He will kill you and deliver you from this birth as an ass." So he cursed him. So the poor fellow had to take birth as an ass. And he was Dhenukasura, very powerful, demon in his pre-born son, in the demoniac line, put it like that. So why Krishna didn't kill him, Balaram? Well, first of all, Durvasa Muni had promised that he would be killed by Balaram, so that words of Durvasa had to be upheld. And the other reason is Krishna had promised Prahlad Maharaj when he was in the form of Vamadeva that he would never, Prahlad Maharaj said he would never kill anyone in his line, his descendants. So being a descendant, Bali Maharaj, a descendant of Prahlad Maharaj, Krishna wouldn't kill him. So it is Balaram's privilege, you could say. He hadn't killed any demons up to this point in time. So this was his turn. We happily took advantage of the opportunity to kill Dhenukasura. Now we're going to go on to a little bit. Let's see what we see. What does Dhenukasura represent? You've all heard a little bit about that, probably. and the nature of Dhenukasura. Well, after Dhenukasura was killed, of course, all the boyfriends were very, very happy. And they were very, very elated by this wonderful heroic feat of Lord Balaram in the Talavan forest. Now, who does Dhenukasura represent? Well, Bhaktivinoda Thakur discusses this in Chaitanya Shikshamrita. There's also in Krishna Samhita and various places we find references to various demons and a little bit about what they represent, their nature, and how by hearing these pastimes, the demoniac propensities within us, I'm sure you've been hearing that from others also, can be killed. So Balaram is special, kills this demon who represents, basically speaking, Dhenukasura represents gross ignorance and terrible discrimination. One who's in the mode of ignorance cannot discriminate properly. They're on the bodily platform of life, identifying with their caste, their color, creed, institutional consciousness, etc. You know, my group, my country, really kind of boxed in there in a very small, understanding of their life for themselves. So they have no sambandha gyan in terms of spiritual knowledge, none. We receive sambandha gyan from the spiritual master. But such fools, they're mudras, ass-like people who work very, very hard and they have no idea of anything. You see them on the street sometimes, those devotees amongst us who go on Sankirtan, distributing books, quite often people say, get a job. Get a job. Do something. Work. Work hard. Make a living. You're useless. Because of people like you, we have to work hard. Sometimes people say things like this. They're ass-like people who have no idea of who they are or what the goal of life is, or even if they have any religiosity whatsoever, it's only on the material platform. And false religionists who teach materialism in the name of spirituality are also ass-like people. Even worse than the ass-like people, they're misguiding people to become even more ass-like, even more ignorant. Asses are very ignorant. And another aspect of an ass is that they see them, you see them not so much in the West maybe, but in India, many of you are from Indian descent. You will see that the ass, especially we see them in Vrindavan, probably elsewhere, but there sometimes the ass is carrying what appears to be, maybe the ass weighs 50 kilos, I don't know, less probably. And he's got like 5 million kilos on his back. I mean, it looks like it. It's like it's piled up. You can't even, all you can see is a couple, four little legs kind of bending out underneath these enormous sacks of cloth and pots and pans and sometimes bricks and sand and whatever they can get on the back of this ass, they put it on there. And the ass has to work like anything for next to nothing. And it just all it gets is a little bit of grass at the end of the day. Ass-like mentality. There's Dhenukasura and his cohorts have this ass-like mentality. And they have no idea who they are, no idea of the goal of life, etc., etc. Completely lacking sambandha gyan. And there's no real gain in their life. They just work for the sake of it. And feel good. They feel like, well, I'm doing well. I'm working hard. I'm an upright member of society. But every species of life is like this. What's the big deal? The ants, the bees, the birds, the animals, they all have the same basic activity. They're just spending their life and acting according to their situation with no real gain at all. They're also very much opposed. When one talks about one's constitutional position, such ass-like personalities have no interest, no belief, no, nothing. It's just a dream, a myth, an illusion. They're completely on the bodily platform of life and very attached to me and mine. Miserly, huh? Miserly people, this Dhenukasura was number one miser. He had so much forest, beautiful fruit tree. They weren't even eating them, not at all, not using it practically. He was just making sure, probably sometimes uses the word sour grapes. Not exactly the same, but it's similar. You don't let anyone, don't want anyone else to have it either. They were really misers, you could say. It's quite a common thing in this world with knowledge, with wealth, with property, and so on. You don't allow anyone else. Not accumulation, another aspect of this, is a burden. Accumulating more and more and more with no real value behind it. They're typical of the material. We may also be victims of this sometimes. There are many other angles which we could look at. They also carry things and gain things. They want things way beyond need, way beyond their capacity or adhikar or eligibility also. Awarding each other with degrees and this and that. And, limiting only people with certain this and that are allowed. It's like our modern society, everything's so controlled, as if the leaders own it or something. Money, everything's so controlled. This is the Dhenukasura mentality. And based on, totally on mundane intelligence, everything's based not on anything spiritual, just on temporary, conditional, logic, reason, conclusions, intelligence based on one's past experience, etc. The Dhenukasura, leaders of society or educationalists and so on, scientists, everything like this is all touched by this Dhenukasura mentality. They are the proprietors. We know, you don't know. They're very proud of their knowledge, etc. So another aspect, Dhenukasura, it also means sometimes, like with scriptures, sometimes the leaders, they don't want people to understand anything more. I'll give you an example. It may have changed now. But many, many years ago in Bali, in Indonesia, I used to be in that part of the world for a while, Arama movement, the Hare Krishna movement, was banned. It was a Muslim country, but it wasn't the Muslims who banned us. It was the Hindus. The Hindu, or there's four religions there allowed. You have to be one or the other. You cannot be another religion. Buddhist, Christian, Hindu, Buddhist, Muslim. So these four religions, so who do we go under? We have to go under the Hindus, and they banned us. They wouldn't allow us to be registered. We were outlawed. Why? Because in Srila Prabhupada's books, it talks about four regulated principles. And this is totally contrary to the local Hindu Brahmins' preaching. They love to eat meat and keep the people in the dark. Sycophant followers, they keep them all in the dark. No, they did, maybe changed now. They used to keep them in the dark. So when Prabhupada's books come in, it started to show them up as cheaters, etc. So they did everything they could to stop the establishment of the Hare Krishna movement in Bali. So this is a kind of an example. Limiting people's advancement in spiritual life, denying them access to, going forward to a higher level of devotional service because of a certain motivation, a selfish motivation maybe, or limited motivation of the leaders. So this happens in religiosity, it can happen in anywhere, any institutional situation. It may happen in our own lives. We don't want to progress. Niyama Agraha, we can read in the Nectar of Instruction, the second verse, how Rupa Goswami describes this obstacle to the progress in spiritual life of Niyama Agraha, of becoming too attached to rules and regulations and thinking that that is the goal and being proud of one's rules and regulations and following so many things, chanting so many rounds, getting up, doing this, that. Fine, it's all part of Vaidhi Bhakti. But we got to realize that that is a stone, stepping stone to a higher stage. It's not the end. It's a means to the end. Yes, we can become more and more transcendental within the practice of that, but our consciousness has to evolve beyond total dependence upon rules and regulations. Now, when our adhikara is not yet developed, or our adhikara is not developed, we have to depend on rules and regulations. And it's a spiritual master who gives us that guidance. Now, Dhenukasura, of course, would not have such an opportunity. He wasn't one to listen to a spiritual master. He thought he was the spiritual master, basically. That's another one. So much pride, and we don't listen to anyone else. And we don't care to listen to anyone else. We only want to distribute our own ignorance to others. So these are Dhenukasura's mentality, blocking others' spiritual advancement, and so on. And the poses. Now, in the literal case, he wasn't eating the fruits himself, but he would oppose anyone. You know, we become envious when somebody advances sometimes, or somebody's got something we haven't got. We try to put it down, we try to take it away, keep them back, etc., etc. It's a very common thing in all walks of life. I mean, it always be the case, but it's a very, very common situation. Try to belittle them, try to make things difficult for them, etc. So Dhenukasura was very envious. If anyone dared to take those fruits, he would get furious. And some and other people have this very gross ignorance of pleasure in the mode of ignorance. I remember one time I was preaching in Newcastle, and one of our devotees there, back in 1980, their grandmother, well, she was very, very rich, but her goal of life was to die with a large amount of money in the bank. She wanted it printed in the newspaper that she had a huge inheritance, a huge amount of wealth. That was her pleasure. That was her goal in life, simply accumulating for no specific reason. And some people are like this. We're all like this to a certain extent. So there we go, working hard, but what for? What's the use of having a beautiful forest with sweet tasting fruits, beautiful tall fruits, very sweet smelling, and not using them? So human life is like that. We have this beautiful opportunity of the human form of life, and we're wasting it away. Kamasya nendriya putya labo jivetiya jivasya tatva jignas natriyascheya karma bihi. Human life is not meant for this sense gratification, whatever form it takes. It is meant for inquiry into the nature of the absolute truth. That should be the goal of all of our work. So what lessons do we learn from this? Anything? I don't know if anyone wants to hear anything, but we'll go through some lessons. What is to be learned? Well, we could say that the coward boys were very eager. Well, they're naturally very eager to increase the pleasure of Krishna. So this is one lesson. We should be very eager to increase Balaram and Krishna's, the spiritual master Balaram and Krishna, to increase their pleasure. Not to increase their, actually the coward boys were thinking of Krishna's pleasure. Just like when they approach pastime is also there, maybe earlier than this, I think, or maybe not, maybe after, I can't remember. But they approach the wives of the Brahmins on the guise that they were hungry. But they just, actually it was not quite like that. They simply wanted to please Krishna. They were thinking maybe Krishna's hungry. He should eat something. They're always thinking of Krishna's pleasure, somehow or another, always eager to increase the pleasure of Krishna. All the genuine devotees, preaching means that. Preaching Krishna consciousness means that. To retrieve, just like the boys were eager, to retrieve the forest of Talavan. In this case, so that the residents of Vrindavan could go there. Actually, the fruits which fell from those trees, especially those which touched the demons or the demons' blood, etc., the boys didn't touch them at all. They weren't really interested in eating the fruit. They were completely self-satisfied. But for the sake of releasing Dhenukasura and pleasing Krishna, Parivrinaya Sadhanam, Vinashya Chandusvitam, Krishna likes to please his devotees, and the devotees like to please Krishna, this whole pastime takes place, and the residents of Vrindavan, the cows and the calves could then graze on the sweet grass which began to grow in the forest. And the fruits, the Sanyasi said that the low class, a lot of low class Kulindu, like Aboriginal people, they would come and eat all those fruits. And I guess in time others did too. So the whole forest was liberated and was thus used then for the pleasure of Krishna. This is preaching. Everything in this material world is a bit like the Taliban forest. And we have to liberate it, free it. And it was Balaram who freed it. So the secret is following the instructions of Balaram, following the spiritual masters and footsteps. So the gopas, they wanted to go, let's go and taste those fruits. They wanted to incite more pleasure pastimes for Krishna. So like that, spiritual master, okay, we can learn another lesson. Balaram is a spiritual master. It kills the idea that something is separate from Krishna. So this Dhenukasura was thinking, these are, like one time, I'll give an example. In New Govardhan in Australia, we have a beautiful temple. And it was customary in Australia at the time that devotees at Rath Yatra or big festivals like Janmashtami or something, they would offer a lot of flowers to Krishna or for the Rath Yatra carts, maybe you do in London. And they would take a little bit of liberty in order to get the flowers. They would go to places here and there. Everything belongs to Krishna, right? Everything is Krishna's property. It's true. But Dhenukasuras don't see it like that. So they were taking flowers from the nearby park. Okay, we don't encourage anyone to do this, by the way. Certainly Prabhupada didn't. But nonetheless, they were doing that. And then one year they went to get to the flowers and there was a big sign up there in the park. These are not Krishna's flowers. Local council will put a big sign there. It's so funny. And in Melbourne one year at the Rath Yatra, the front page article, it was an article about the botanical gardens, the flower gardens there, how during the night, it said, somebody had raided the garden and all the rose bushes were stripped. It was an article, you know, night raiders steal the roses. And then the article right next to it was gorgeous Rath Yatra. The Rath Yatra cart bedecked with the most beautiful roses. It was like right next to each other on the front page. They obviously realized what was going on. It's just what to do. Actually, everyone should be offering all of their flowers for the pleasure of Krishna. That's what they're for. It's one of the lessons to realize everything beautiful is meant to be offered to Krishna. These tall fruits were very sweet. They should be offered to Krishna. But the Dhenukasura type people think they belong to me. They're mine. They're ours. You don't touch them. They'd rather not be used than you have them. There's one mentality. They'd rather it be destroyed. And many times people would say that. And Prabhupada in London, when they were looking at some buildings in 1969, for temples in 1970 in London, one of the buildings was an old church, and they said they'd rather burn it down than sell it to us. The Dhenukasura mentality, so-called religion, with no idea, no sambandha, no knowledge of one's spiritual identity, no knowledge of the fact of Ishavasyamidam Sarvam, everything belongs to God, no knowledge. People think it's ours. Yeah, everyone can see that all over the world. You don't have to have many eyes to see that. It's quite obvious. You know, the possessive mentality on a national level, on a religious level, on an economic level, on a social level, on a gender level, on a creed level, on every level we see this false possessiveness, which is this mentality of Dhenukasura also. We'll come to a little practical side in a minute. We're just pointing out some things now, not particularly in chronological order of any kind. The falling fruits. We could see Balaram comes along, he jerks the trees, the fruits fall. So it would, by the grace of Balaram, all of our material desires could be likened to fruits. They can fall. We just got to make sure we don't eat them. We don't indulge in them again, so to speak. But they can fall. The spiritual master shakes us up. And he shakes us up, you know. And what happens when we get shaken up? What's going on here? You know, like he was in it, having a nap. We suddenly wake up. What's going on? And Dhenukasura and all his cohorts appear on the scene. No, stop. After a few minutes, and they appear on the scene. What about me? This is mine. Come, enjoy. Whatever it is, all kinds of things may crop up in our consciousness when the spiritual master begins his purificatory instruction. Sometimes there's objections, doubts, so on. It depends, but often that's the case. Many an artist. So we have to kill, we have to root out this ignorance, kill this demon, this Dhenukasura. Now getting to the actual philosophical side, you could say, this gross ignorance of identity, this false possessiveness, this miserliness, this greediness of accumulating more and more for no real value, this not wanting anyone else to enjoy what one thinks is mine, all these various things, identifying oneself with a body, not really wanting to surrender, but wanting to be recognized amongst other fools as some serious person, Dhenukasura was a leader of asses. What's the big value, you know? Fame amongst the infamous, you know, amongst, I probably didn't use the term, you know, you're famous amongst a group of asses, so what? You're a big, you know, the king of the asses. Who cares? A jackass. And they call him a jackass. The boy, Krishna at first would say to the boy, when they would say this powerful demon, what is some ass? Powerful? Is this a joke? Jackass? How can he be so dangerous and fearful? They were playing it off like a game. If it was, for them it was a game. Prabhupada said, preaching Krishna consciousness one time, he wrote this letter in England to Prohibition Era Sangatan Party, 72, that it's just like fun, although there's so many obstacles, so many problems, just like play. Sankirtan, spreading the holy names everywhere. This is this mission, to bring everything back. Just like Lord Chaitanya. Let's look at the difference here between Dhenukasura. I'm going to read something from Chaitanya Charitamrita. Something which really struck us. This was the first volume that was ever printed of Chaitanya Charitamrita, the second volume in our present series. Krishna Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was the original trunk, the taste of the fruits that grew on the branches and sub-branches surpassed the taste of nectar. The fruits ripened and became sweet and nectarian. The gardener, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, distributed them without asking any price. See the difference? All the wealth in the three worlds cannot equal the value of one such nectarian fruit of devotional service. Not considering who asked for it and who did not, nor who was fit and who was unfit to receive it, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu distributed the fruit of devotional service. The transcendental gardener, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, distributed handful after handful of fruit in all directions. And when the poor, hungry people ate the fruit, the gardener smiled with great pleasure. This is the magnanimity of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's Sangatana, who doesn't discriminate, simply based on the fact that every living entity needs Krishna consciousness. We don't keep it for ourselves. This is a very important point, Prabhupada describes that we have to distribute this Krishna, these fruits of devotional service must be distributed. We don't just keep them for ourselves. Lord Chaitanya thus addressed the multifarious varieties of branches and sub-branches of the tree of devotional service. Since the tree of devotional service is transcendental, every one of its parts can perform the actions of all the others. Although a tree is supposed to be immovable, this tree nevertheless moves. All the parts of this tree are spiritually cognizant, and thus as they grow up, they spread all over the world. I am the only gardener. How many places can I go? How many fruits can I pick and distribute? It would certainly be a very laborious task to pick the fruits and distribute them alone. And still I suspect that some would receive them and others would not. Therefore, I order every man within this universe to accept this Krishna consciousness movement and distribute it everywhere. And we don't have time to read the fantastic purport of Srila Prabhupada on this theme. I am the only gardener, Lord Chaitanya said. If I do not distribute these fruits, what shall I do with them? How many fruits can I alone eat? By the transcendental desire of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, water has been sprinkled all over the tree, and thus there are innumerable fruits of love of Godhead. Distribute this Krishna consciousness all over the world. Let people eat these fruits and ultimately become free from old age and death. If the fruits are distributed all over the world, my reputation as a pious man will be known everywhere, and thus all people will glorify my name with great pleasure. One who has taken his birth as a human being in the land of India, Bharat Varsh, should make his life successful and work for the benefit of all other people. It is the duty of every living entity to perform welfare activities for the benefit of others with his life, wealth, intelligence, and works. By his work, thoughts, and words, an intelligent man must perform actions which will be beneficial for all living entities in this life and in the next. I am merely a gardener. I have neither a kingdom nor very great riches. I simply have some fruits and flowers that I wish to utilize to achieve piety in my life. Although I'm acting as a gardener, I also want to be the tree, for thus I can bestow benefit upon all. And it goes on. They're just describing the nature of this Sangatana movement, that everybody, all together, we have to go into the forest with Balaram at the helm. He leads us into the forest, the spiritual master, and deliver all of this falsity in the world, all the usurped property, etc., of the conditioned souls, claiming proprietorship, and utilize it for the pleasure of Krishna. And we start with our own body, with our own mind. Our own mind, our own heart may be full of the mentality of Dhenukasura itself. There we have to start. We have to start cleaning up our own gardens, our own hearts. Then it will be natural that we will spread this Krishna consciousness movement. We have to take shelter of Balaram. Balaram appears in the form of the spiritual master. When we take shelter of Balaram, all kinds of demons can be killed by the grace of the spiritual master. Many anartas can be smashed just by understanding our spiritual identity, remembering our spiritual identity, reminding each other, try to live our lives based on our fact that we are eternal servants of Krishna. So many anartas become insignificant. They become incapacitated. They can't act. Here's a nice quote from Prabhupada, which I'll read. This is a letter which he wrote to Krishna Das in 1972. Prabhupada says, you mentioned that your pathway has become filled with stumbling blocks, but there are no stumbling blocks. I can kick out all those stumbling blocks immediately, provided you accept my guidance. With one stroke of my kick, I can kick out all stumbling blocks. This is Prabhupada. No matter what we envision as an obstacle, a problem, if we take shelter of Balaram or as representative of the spiritual master, they could all be kicked out, removed immediately. When devotees would come into Prabhupada's association many times, they had this experience full of anxiety. As soon as you sit before Prabhupada, no more anxiety. It just doesn't seem to exist, practically speaking. Many devotees had that experience. So the genuine spiritual master like Balaram, he didn't cover over, certainly wasn't afraid. Let's see what Srila Prabhupada like Balaram. He wasn't afraid to go in there. He wasn't afraid of the Dhenukasura demon. He completely had no fear. He just threw him in the trees. Very easy. Prabhupada used to, no fear. No matter what type of nonsense challenges people had, objections they had, Prabhupada was fearless. He would deal with them. So if we want to get rid of Dhenukasuras, we have to take genuine shelter of the spiritual master. Now, let's see if I can remove this a minute. Just hold on. Yes, the heart, if we take shelter, the heart should become, just like the Taliban forest became peaceful. It became beautiful again with the fresh breezes and the fresh grasses. Our heart should become soft again by following those instructions, not hard-hearted, angry, envious, proud, attached, etc., etc. Good qualities should start to manifest again. And some Radhanath Swami, there's a beautiful talk by Radhanath Maharaj. He talks a little bit about this, which I'll read it in a minute. Krishna is devotees. When the heart becomes very soft and very attractive, Krishna's devotees, they want to enter in there, just like they did in the Taliban forest. Of course, at first, it was like a Sangatan mission to reclaim all the fruits and the trees and everything else and kill the demons. But eventually, it was basically to provide another pleasure place for Krishna and his associates to enjoy. They came again, entering, dancing, enjoying the fruits of our service. So the Lord will come into our hearts and enjoy the fruits of our service. Otherwise, if our service is tainted with the blood of Dhenukasura, Krishna and his associates won't enjoy it. They didn't enjoy it because it was tainted with Dhenukasura's blood and his cohorts. In other words, tainted with these ill attitude or bad attitude or selfish attitude, greedy attitude, whatever it may be, envious, proud, and so on. We may be doing this, that, and the other, but that's not enjoyable to Krishna. He wants to see it with the pretty lakshanam and pure, without the taint of demoniac mentality, so to speak, or sinful or materialistic mentality. So, yes, when the heart is rid of Dhenukasura and his cohorts, the fruits of our hearts are being consumed by ass-like demons. They're actually eating up our hearts, really, practically speaking. And what are they? Lust, greed, anger, envy. These various animosities, enemies of the soul. Enemies, just like Devaki when she gave birth to Krishna. Six children were killed by Kamsa in the womb. They represent envy, lust, greed, anger, madness, and illusion. They represent these six enemies of the soul killed. They were killed. This is all arranged. But then, the womb. Who comes next? The spiritual master to clean up, you could say, clean up the womb. It's allegorical, but it's the principle which is there. Clean up the womb of Devaki so that Krishna was then ready for Krishna's appearance. We have to prepare our hearts. Kill these Dhenukasuras in our heart. They have to be killed by the mercy of the spiritual master. As long as we continue in this world, basically aspiring for material progress, we are just like ass-like demons, just like Dhenuka. Yes. And this effort to improve our lot in this material just never ends. It just goes on and on and on. Frustrations, anxieties, misunderstandings, and birth and death, and so on. You have to give up this foolish endeavor. So here's something from Radhanath Maharaj. Sitting within our hearts, I almost something missed out there. I think it's, I'm not sure. Maybe it's referring to these demoniac mentality. Consequently, we are becoming more and more selfish and egoistic and not allowing Krishna and his devotees to perform their pastimes within the Taliban of our heart. Krishna's sweet holy name doesn't even stay within our heart. So what is our hope? We see that it goes, it just doesn't reside, it doesn't stick. It's just like going on, but it's not sticking. Balaramji represents the guru, spiritual master. When we allow the guru to enter our heart through his instructions, through his example, and through his inspiration, he thoroughly shakes up our false conceptions of being the proprietor and the selfish enjoyer of the things of this world. Just like Balaramji shook the tall tall trees and instigated Dhenukasura, when we take shelter of the instructions of the spiritual master and sincerely try to follow them, the Dhenukasuras of lust, envy, anger, pride, greed, and illusion get destroyed by the mercy of the spiritual master. Only by the grace of the spiritual master can we get rid of these demoniac contaminations within our hearts. And when our heart thus becomes pure and selfless, then Krishna and all his devotees again enter and frolic within the talavan of our heart and enjoy the fruits of our love and our service. This is the idea. There should be some fruits in our heart which are worthy of distribution. Who wants to receive something from a hard-hearted person? A person who's full of anger and lust and greed, anxiety and so on and so forth, to cleanse all these sources, not just the effects, but the sources. Why are we in anxiety? Why are we this? Why are we that? Because there's something behind it all, ignorance, forgetting our genuine relationship with Krishna. We're still on the platform of identifying ourselves with this body and mind as a self. We haven't dedicated it to Krishna. It takes time. And the spiritual master is there to teach us how we can do this. We have to follow him. My and my. We keep fighting with everyone around us and we try to grab things. As Krishna says in the Bhagavad, everything belongs to him. Aham sarvasya prabhavo mataksarvam pravartati. Nothing belongs to us at all. Everything's for Krishna. So who are we to prevent others from enjoying the fruits that have been created by the Lord for all people? Prabhupada talks about this many times. Who are we to say this is our land? You can't come here. This is Dhenukasura mentality. The customs, the immigration, and so on. You cannot come in. You haven't got a visa. Blah, blah, blah. What to do? This is the Kali Yuga. Even after understanding it's wrong to have this attitude, such an artist might keep cropping up in our minds. We may, you know, we may destroy a certain aspect, but the tendency to do it is still there in our hearts. It's not just about removing it on the surface, but the cause whereby all these weeds keep coming up in our lives, how to get rid of them. We have to get to the root. And Rupa Goswami says, how? We have to chant very carefully and regularly according to the direction given by Balaram. I don't know if we're going to have time to finish this. I don't know how much time we have. I don't think we're going to have time. Huh? What's the time? What's the time out there?
Hare Krishna Maharaj, you have about 10 minutes more.
10 minutes more. Oh, yeah, we'll keep going if there's anyone left. If they haven't all been captured by Dhenukasura or delivered from Dhenukasura, it's not possible to give up these bad thoughts and cleanse our hearts on our own. We need to take shelter of Lord Balaram and surrender unto him. When we do so, just like how we carried and threw Dhenukasura away, he will also kill all the anartas in our heart. In Srimad Bhagavatam, Lord Krishna. Oh, I think that's something else. So we also have to be careful not to let Dhenukasura back in again. Huh? Wanting to chase them away, but we have to get rid of him altogether. Kill him thoroughly, wheel them around, throw them in the trees. Never again can he come back and haunt us. This is taking full shelter of Krishna, not taking shelter of the temporary objects of this world. You have to go. No, change of plan. Okay. Hare Krishna. And we may have other things too. We have secret agendas in our hearts which we hold on to sometimes, like grim death. We don't want to reveal them. We don't want to let go of them. We're maybe afraid. We may be embarrassed or whatever it may be. And we may be attached to them even though they bring pain to us. So many different types of attachments are there. Hare Krishna. So we'll finish then with Balaram. Lord Balaram, a removal of anartas. He's a very important part to play. Anarta Oh, it's a nice verse. This is from Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati. Anartanageli Nami Guna Bhuja Jayana. Anartanageli Nami Krishna Seva Hayana. If an artist are not removed, then the holy name will never produce knowledge of the divine qualities of Krishna. If anartas are not destroyed by the chanting of the holy name, one can never engage in service to Krishna, real service. So we have to remove these anartas, whether it's Dhenukasura or whatever asura it is, they all have to be removed. Well, Bhaktivinoda Thakur describes by hearing these pastimes as the killing of the demons. This is one of the ways that we get rid of these specific anartas. So by hearing how Dhenukasura is killed, many different descriptions are there. It helps to remove this tendency of gross ignorance and possessiveness and miserliness and so on. One cannot attain the goal of life without the mercy of Balaram. When one receives the mercy of Lord Balaram Nityananda, one can attain lotus feet of Radha and Krishna very easy, as a prayer book by Srila Prabhupada. Balaram, our original spiritual master, teaches us there is no need to unnecessarily carry the big burden of our materialistic responsibilities. And there is no need to carry the fruits of our activity, our possessions for our own enjoyment, should offer it to Krishna. This is how Dhenukasura, or the donkey demon, is killed by Balaram, by thinking and acting how everything can be offered to Krishna. Thakur Bhaktivinod explains, can you come back here? Explains that these two anartas have to be overcome by the endeavor of the devotee. That's the anartas represented by Dhenuka and by Palamba. Under the guidance and instruction of the spiritual master, the devotee must endeavor with all sincerity. It's not just grace. Grace in the sense that grace of Balaram would come. The grace of Balaram comes through Guru, will come to exterminate these demons forever, providing we really struggle and endeavor to give up the propensity for profit, adoration, distinction, and gross sense gratification. Thus endeavor, praying to Guru and Krishna and chanting the holy names, we can become blessed by the causeless mercy of the Lord. Yeah, so the easiest way to get in touch with Lord Balaram, of course, is through a bona fide spiritual master, representative of Lord Balaram. Balaram is the Adi Guru, and he's present where there's a genuine spiritual master giving his instructions, guidelines, how to be cleaned of all these anartas, so we can enter into the pastimes or enter into the mood of pleasing Krishna. And here's a few quotes, we'll finish with this, from Srila Prabhupada. So if you remain strong in your spiritual activities, these agasura, bakasura, this one, they all come and go. But we should take precaution and counteract to reduce them. Real strength will remain from Krishna Balaram's strength. Balaram means strength. Nayam atma balayina na labhyaha. If you are not supported by Balaram, then it is not possible. So we have got our Balaram, Krishna Balaram temple. And then Prabhupada says, now in Europe, we have also got Krishna Balaram, Gopal Krishna. In France, Prabhupada, yes. Gargamini, which place? Outside the farm? Prabhupada, very nice. Gopal Krishna, exactly like Vrindavan, I heard. The deities are exactly, they're right downstairs below us here. Krishna and Balaram in New Mayapur. Prabhupada says, significant, this is from the Bhagavatam purport. Significant in this verse are the words Gyani Sim Chutabalaha. Gyani Sim means the sword of knowledge is given by Krishna. And when one serves the Guru and Krishna in order to hold the sword of Krishna's instructions, Balaram gives one strength. Balaram is Nityananda, Bhujanda Nandana, Ye, Shachi Sutta Hila Se, Balaram Ahila Nitai. This Balaram comes with Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and both of them are so merciful that in this age of Kali, one may very easily take shelter of their lotus feet. They come especially to deliver the fallen souls of this age. Papitapi yatachila, Hariname udarila. Their weapon is Sankirtan. Harinam. Thus one should accept the sword of knowledge from Krishna and be strong with the mercy of Balaram. We are therefore worshipping Krishna Balaram in Vrindavan. In the Mudaka Upanishad it is said, Naiyam atma balaine na labhyo na cha pamatat tapaso vapyam lingat. Etarupayar yatate yastu vidvams tasyaiva atma vishate brahmataham. One cannot attain the goal of life without the mercy of Balaram. Sri Narottam Das Thakur therefore says, Nitayada karuna habe, Braje Radha-Krishna pabe. When one receives the mercy of Balaram Nityananda, one can attain the lotus feet of Radha and Krishna very easily. Se sambandhan nahijar, Brita janmagelata, Vidya kule ki karivita. If one has no connection with Nitai or Balaram, then even though one is very learned scholar or jnani, or has taken birth in a very respectable family, these assets will not help him. We must therefore conquer the enemies of Krishna consciousness with the strength received from Balaram. Hare Krishna. Okay, that's that. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna Maharaj, thank you so much. We have a few questions. Would you like me to start reading them out for you?
Okay, they're on the chat.
Kumar Nimai Prabhu. If one's astrological chart...
Krishna, Krishna, Hare, Hare. It's just... what's this? You would like to follow the reading of the past time. Okay. Okay, the first four aren't really questions.
Okay. I can read them out for you, Mara. Did you like?
Oh, I can read them. No problem.
Okay, fine. I just...
Everything belongs to Krishna. You mentioned Srila Prabhupada did not want the devotees to steal people's flowers for Krishna's service. So that disturbed people. So how do we inspire people who may be a bit resistant to willingly offer their assets in service to Krishna, as we want them to benefit from giving without disturbing them? Well, yeah, of course, for the preaching point of view, we have to bear in mind the effects of what we do. This principle is established by the behavior of the devotees. So, the devotee, Prabhupada said, should be a gentleman. We should show a good example. So I guess we have to start. Charity begins at home. Utilize what we've got, then Krishna will give us more. A lot of the times we have a lot of land and property, and what are we growing? We're going to the market to buy vegetables and flowers, and we've got 100 acres of barren land. So obviously Krishna's not going to be very inspired by that. So charity begins at home. We have to show ourselves. It's very hard to preach to people and we're not doing it ourselves. Even in your own garden, sometimes they're just concrete jungles or dumping grounds or just grass. We have to show people how to utilize things for Krishna. It's not just about telling people. If we don't do it ourselves, I think it's not going to be much of an example. It's not going to be not going to go very deep in people's minds, you know. We're living in palaces, we're living in opulent lives, etc. Maybe because of our situation in life, there may be some justification for that sometimes. But generally speaking, a devotee is supposed to live simply and high thinking, simple living. Like that, we have to show the example. People won't be inspired otherwise. And when they see how nice it is to live like that, that was one of Prabhupada's constitutions, two of them, in fact, to create a place where we could live simply and people could come and just see for themselves and experience Krishna consciousness. But otherwise, it's a little difficult. And they come to the temple, no one talks to you or whatever it is. But it's if you live in the city, it's different. But, you know, when we've got land, we have to show how to utilize these things or everything in life, whatever we've got. People will be inspired when they see that those so-called, those who are representing the spiritual master are utilizing their lives in the right way. So that otherwise it's going to be a little long run in. It's like in the early years of this movement, Prabhupada was, of course, personally present at the helm, and devotees were so much, were only temple devotees. We didn't have a congregation then, really speaking. But they were so surcharged and literally 18 hours a day, flat out in devotional service without break for a second. Hearing, chanting, serving, washing, cleaning, chanting, sankirtan, deity worship, cooking, full on. In this way, it's like a whirlwind. People get swept up. what do you call these things? Suck everything into them. Incredible. So there has to be something to be attracted to. The philosophy is like lifeless unless people see life. Yeah, many times people say good philosophy, but where's the practice we have to see? What is the practice? You know? See it in life. Hare Krishna. Yeah, so we want people to benefit by giving, but giving in the mode of different natures is there also. We want people to give willingly, happily. They must get some taste in giving. And that means the thing, if they give and they see it's not being utilized the way they thought it was going to be utilized, they'll definitely not be very inspired. When they see the devotees living simply, this is how the Brahmins live. The temples are meant to be Brahmin houses. They're not business houses. They're not places for Vaishya and Kshatriya business. It's purely Brahminical, the temple. And people naturally want to give when they see Brahmins who are selfless, who are simply there to serve, or fully absorbed in hearing and chanting. Naturally, people will want to give. It's only natural. Everyone's probably had, I've had that experience again and again. So it's just natural. Because the Brahmins give everything to Krishna. They don't keep anything for themselves. Like, they're not Dhenukasuras. What's your name, Prabhu? Dhenukasura Das. Oh. We're supposed to be Krishna Das or Krishna Das, 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 Anu Das. And see, whenever we offer whatever we have, if we offer that Krishna, Krishna will automatically provide more. He'll give more. Hare Krishna, thank you for the questions. Keep coming. Hare Krishna, can you repeat the books you read out, please? Did I? Chaitanya Charitamrita. We read the Krishna book in the beginning, Dhenukasura. Then we read from Chaitanya Charitamrita. I think that was the only two books I read from. I quoted from a few places here and there. I can't give it a reference on the spot, but I could probably find them with a bit more time at hand. But we read from Chaitanya Charitamrita. What chapter was it? Can you tell me? The book's been closed, so I can't say. I think it's chapter 8 or 9 of the Adilila. This one. Chapter 8. No, I don't think so. Maybe 9. Let's see. Yeah, chapter 9, text 25 onwards. Adilila. Chaitanya Charitamrita. Hare Krishna. Well, everything below, we mentioned that one. Balaram represents the guru and smashes our false identity and belief system. But what if we struggle to fulfill the instructions and desires of our spiritual master? Have we failed? How do we not feel disheartened? Oh, you're struggling. That means you're trying. Endeavoring. That means we're endeavoring. Krishna understands one's endeavor. It's not, some people, maybe for whatever reason, have no problem following certain things. That doesn't necessarily mean that they're actually surrendering to Krishna. Some people can get up in the morning at 2 o'clock without any ado. And, you know, there's different things for them are very easy. So when Krishna sees we're struggling for him, sincerely struggling, then that's very big. That's Krishna's very pleased with our endeavors. It certainly is very difficult to become free of the anartas. It's only by the mercy of Balaram we make our endeavor, but ultimately it's by his mercy. When we realize, what can I do? You know, when the desire is there, we want to surrender to Krishna. We want to get free of these, you know, these bugs in the system. We want to get free of them. And they keep bugging us. You know, they keep Dhenukasuras and this sura and that sura come back again and again, keep bugging us. And what is the purpose of all this? We take shelter of Krishna. You take shelter of Krishna. You know, if one's for good karma or maybe a little bit from a previous life or something pious for some reason, no problem with these difficulties, so-called difficulties of this and that, but we may not be taking shelter of Krishna. Somebody else has got all kinds of problems, but they're actually crying to Krishna. I'm so fallen. I'm so overwhelmed with material desires. Krishna, I'm so wretched. Sometimes that mood is there. That's the mood of surrendering to Krishna. This is the meaning of endeavoring to surrender to Krishna, taking shelter of Krishna. We all know the story of the Garuda and the sparrow, you know, trying to trying to dry up the ocean. What a joke, materially speaking, is impossible. But because of the sincere endeavor, struggling like anything, the Guru came along to help. So this, if we have this faith, then that alone is our ticket to go back to the spiritual world. It's not just about being able to do A, B, C, and D. It's actually taking shelter of Krishna, the attitude, the consciousness. Those are very important things. It looks to honest, it looks like you do have a sincere attitude. Anything else? Is that it?
Hare Krishna Maharaj.
Oh, there's one here. There's another one. There's a few.
Hare Krishna Maharaj. Sorry to interrupt. We're actually now reached the end of the time for the session. So
it's the end of time. It's all over. The universe is coming to an end. You better start chanting quickly. Otherwise it'll be too late. Yes. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, thank you so much.
Transcend your astrology, it says here. Yes, you can transcend it in one sense. We have to transcend it, but you may still act according to it. The soul is not a machine. The soul is a conscious living entity with free will. So we transcend it, rise above these modes of nature and chant, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare. Hare Rama, 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 Hare Hare. Thank you all very, very much. We wish you an ecstatic remainder of the Kartik season, and I hope you get opportunities to distribute millions of books during the Crop Hunt Book Marathon, somehow or another. Where there's a will, there's a way. Hare Krishna.